Welcome back. You're still watching Metropol Television. My name is Elijah Charles. Can I get you right within our sector trends, where we get to tell you exactly what is happening in other areas of the economy other than just business for business. But it's still business. All right. Now, let me introduce the next subject. When you hear the word a leader, what comes to mind? How can you define a leader? Now, today, we look into leadership traits or qualities that make a leader. And joining us this morning is Dr. Mary Mugo, who is a senior lecturer at one of Kenya's public universities. Good morning, Dr. Mary Mugo. How are you doing?
Good morning, Simba. How are you?
I am fantastic. Hopefully, you are too. How was your, weekend? A long one in that matter.
My weekend was good. We thank God. You know, you've got to thank God for what you have. It was fantastic. Let me use your words. It was fantastic.
It's got to be fantastic. I mean, if it was, then I'm happy for you as well. All right, Dr. Mary Mugo, let's start by defining the term a leader, but in respect to the workplace. I don't know whether it gets a different meaning altogether.
Yeah, thank you, Simba. People have confused a leader with someone who either owns a position. They have confused a leader with their supervisor. You can be in a position, you can be a supervisor, you can even be an MP, but you're not a leader.
Yes.
A leader is anyone who can motivate people to achieve a goal or a purpose. A leader is someone who can influence other people to achieve something. And that influence is not coercive. You don't influence through coercing people or forcing people. So a leader is someone who simply is able to motivate people, to influence people to achieve a purpose.
Yes.
That is what a leader is. And Simba, allow me to say that the word leader, from an English perspective, simply means someone who guides. Mm-hmm. A leader means someone who is in charge. That is what a leader is.
So let's talk about this term in respect to the workplace. Does it sort of tend to have a different meaning, Dr. Mary Mugo, when you are talking about a leader in respect to workplace setting?
Yeah, actually, when you talk about a leader in a workplace, let's say where you are, for example,
yes,
is someone who is able to make you guys as staff members to achieve the goals of the organization.
Yes.
It is someone who is able to influence you to do what should be done without coercing you, without intimidating you, without, you know, making you do it by force. That is what a leader is in an organization. Are you able to achieve the goals of the organization through people without intimidating them, without coercing them? That is a leader in an organization setup.
That's it. I like when we have this sort of conversations, Dr. Mary Mugo, because then indeed it gives me a chance to also throw in personal questions and really trying to understand this particular area. Now, there's a personal one, Dr. Mary Mugo. Do we normally get it wrong at the workplace? And I'm talking about the human resource officers. When anybody who's got to be a leader is someone who comes in with a higher qualification, with experience at work, which does not necessarily make you a leader or a proper head of department. Does it, Dr. Mary Mugo? Are we looking at a space where we can say that a head of department does not necessarily have to be the most qualified when it comes to the papers, but it's got to be the most qualified when it comes to those particular leadership skills?
Yeah, Simba, a competence does not necessarily make you a leader.
Yes.
But without competence, you definitely will not be an effective leader. So yes,
that's wait a minute, Dr. Mary Mugo. Wait, that competence doesn't necessarily make you a good leader. But then without competence, you can be a leader. Is that what we get it wrong?
Yeah, you see, I'm saying that competence does not necessarily make you a good leader, but yes, lack of it will undo your leadership.
I see.
So competence is important, but it's not everything. Because Simba, you must know what you're doing. You must have knowledge and skills. But you can have all those knowledge and skills, but still you are not a good leader.
Important, therefore, I like how you're putting it, that you might know exactly what it is that you're doing, but you're not necessarily a good leader. So master leader, all right, be the most qualified then in terms of academic competence. Is that where it starts?
No, not really. You see, Simba, this aspect of leadership, our leadership has been misunderstood.
Yes.
People must go to school, people must be qualified, but that does not necessarily mean because you have a PhD like I do and you do not have Simba, you cannot make a good leader.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that. You can have all the academic qualifications in this world, but you still can't make a good leader. Because competence, as much as competence is one of the key qualities of a good leader, it is not the only thing. That is why, Simba, you find leaders who are extremely learned, but they are idiotic in the way they do things. Because you can be competent, for example, but you have no character. You can be competent, but you can't speak to people. You can be competent, but you are full of yourself. So competence in itself is good, but it is you are good.
I see that. Which therefore makes me ask you this question this morning. And I do know you listened to that nationwide conversation of whether members of parliament should have a degree or not, Dr. Mary Mugo. And they were saying that for you to be a leader, it's not about academic qualification. It's about your personal traits, your inter and intrapersonal traits that you may have that are actually going to propel you to be a good leader. Where do you stand in that divide, Dr. Mary Mugo, in respect to this morning conversation?
Simba, MPs should have a degree. Why? Because of the kind of job they do.
Yes.
You cannot legislate and you don't understand nothing.
That's the competence element that you are talking about, isn't it?
Yes. You can't be in parliament. You cannot speak well, you cannot debate, you cannot legislate. So competence in terms of education is important for any leader, especially in a national assembly, for the simple reason, the kind of job they do. You see, sometimes, Simba, people have misunderstood what an MP does.
Yes.
An MP is supposed to legislate. How do you legislate if you don't even know what the law says? You can't read, you can't speak well. I mean, for me, it is important that at a certain level, in fact, for me, depending on what you do at certain levels, education and more so academic qualifications become very important. But Simba, allow me to say that competence is not just about academic qualifications.
Yes.
For you to say you're competent, you must be able to actually do what you do and do it repeatedly. Do you know what you're doing? And if you know what you're doing, are you able to apply what you're doing to your task? Because there are also people who are A students, like I am, Simba, but they are not able to apply their A student aspect to the job. So you must be, yes, it is good to be an A student, but are you able to apply that? So it is one thing to actually be knowledgeable, Simba. It's another thing to apply that knowledge to what you do. So you must apply your knowledge to what you do, Simba.
So let's therefore pick what would be your three top qualities of a good leader at the workplace, Dr. Mary Mugo.
Simba, good leader number one must be courageous,
yes,
in my view. You must have the courage to do the right thing. You must have the courage to be unpopular as long as you know what you're doing is right. You must be there, have the courage to say no and stand for the truth. So a good leader, number one, must have courage.
Yes.
Number two, a good leader must have character. Character is known in how you do things, not what you become. Are you able to act in a way that inspires trust in your people? Are you able to act in a way that inspires and generates honesty? So you must have character. And Simba, you have heard people saying that you can be, you, anything can take you to the top, really, but it is character that keeps you there. What do you do as a leader? How do you do as a leader? The third key thing is integrity, Simba. Without integrity, nothing works. A good leader must be someone who has integrity. When we talk about integrity, you must honor your word. You must be able to keep your word. You cannot be a good leader who is not whole. You cannot be a good leader who never keeps their word, who never honors their word. You don't pay your staff on time. You tell them I'll pay you. You don't pay them. You don't even care to tell them you'll not pay them. A good leader must be someone who has integrity. And you must be able to honor your word. When you say something, that is your word. When you promise something, do it. A good leader must have integrity. There are many other qualities, Simba, of a good leader, but those are key. Of course, competence is another one. Communication is also key because, Simba, we say that leadership rises or falls on communication.
Yes.
If you cannot communicate effectively, you travel alone. So as a good leader, you must be able to communicate. You must be able to listen to the people that you lead. Otherwise, you travel alone and you not achieve the objectives of the organization that you lead. Thank you, Simba.
Since we are talking about those qualities of a good leader, I've got this, maybe it's a misconception, maybe it's the truth, and they say this, that a bad leader is liked by all the employees. A good leader is hated by all the employees. Is that true? Is that statement true?
No, that statement is not true. You see, you need to understand that leadership is not a popularity context or
yes.
a beauty context, for that matter.
But it's gotta be, Dr. Mary Mugo, depending on how you look at it.
You see, the question we should be asking ourselves, Simba, is now that you are so popular as a leader, are you achieving the objectives of the organization? But you see, if you are a good leader, by the way, you people like you and people want to associate with you. And I'll tell you what, there is no bad leader who is like, give me an example. Because bad leaders, one, they will never even care about what they do. A bad leader will make sure that nothing works. A bad leader is someone who is never there for the employees. Which kind of employee would like that kind of a leader, Sim?
Which bad in the sense of ineffective, you find that most leaders don't care about output and about how, let me just talk about that, output are the ones who tend to be liked by the employees. But those who really stick to that and care specifically about that output and how we work and how we're supposed to perform are the ones that most employees don't like.
Yeah, you see, those kind of employees are the lazy employees. They are the employees who do nothing. They are employees who basically should have been fired yesterday. Because why do you want to stay in an organization where there is no output? Why do you want to stay in an organization that is dying? So those are the employees which human resource management should fire. Simple.
Yes.
You cannot stay in an organization, even as a leader, and you don't care about the organization. You don't care if the organization is going down. You are not worthy of being called a leader, Simba.
So let's address this then. Being a leader, is it something that you can study, that you can learn and be good at it? Or it's something that comes naturally, that people are not good leaders, but they could be good employees?
As a leader, you can either be born or you can be made.
Yes.
That's a debate that people keep asking. Leaders can be made, leaders can be born.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? There are leaders who, or there are people who have, you know, the traits or the enduring characteristics that automatically make them a leader. In terms of, they have social skills, they have interpersonal skills, they have courage, they can communicate, they are competent. But there are others who are not necessarily born leaders, but over time, as they practice leadership, or rather as they exercise leadership, as they even cultivate some of those qualities, they become good leaders. So a leader can also be made. Sometimes you know better leaders, you know good leaders through a crisis. There are leaders who are made because there's a crisis in the office. Your boss did not show up, or your boss has resigned, or there are so many things that have happened. And all of a sudden, it is simple now who is the boss. You just find yourself that you must make decisions, you must communicate, you must do things. So leaders can also be made. You can learn to be a good leader. You can learn by reading books. You can learn by, and after you read the books, you exercise what you're reading. I think the major problem is people are full of knowledge in their hands, but unfortunately, they don't apply knowledge. That's why I say, Simba, applied knowledge is power. It is not just knowledge. Do you apply what you know? So yes, leadership can be learned, Simba.
Fantastic, Dr. Mary Mugo. Thank you very much for taking your time this morning to address this area that is, it's actually a big issue that we maybe would like to talk about that as well in the next conversation, how to treat bad leaders at work as an employee, because in many respects, Dr. Mary Mugo, that's what majority of employees run into, and you have no way to actually get out of the grip of a bad leader. Maybe that for next conversation, if you can.
That's fine, Simba. I'm always here. I am available to discuss this topic, because this is a topic that is in my heart. Because when everything falls and rises on leadership, if you see an organization that is not going well, don't blame anybody else, blame the leaders. But of course, followers also have their part. But at the end of the day, as a good leader, followers will follow you without a lot of issues. So yes, it is important to know who is a bad leader and what do you do about that bad leader. So anytime, Simba.
And that could be just a better intro into our next conversation. Thank you very much for taking your time.
Thank you. Thank you, Simba. Have yourself a great week and God bless you.
Fantastic. Let's take that break.
Dissecting the Heart of Leadership by Dr. Mary Mugo. Dr. Mary Mugo is an innovator, an author, and motivational speaker with vast experience from academia, consultancies, leadership, marketing, and human resource management. In her book, Dissecting the Heart of Leadership, she covers the following topics. 1. The concept of leadership. How to inspire and empower people, share the vision, and lead the change. 2. Effective delegation. 3. Effective management of meetings. 4. Leading in turbulent times. 5. Managing teams and team building. 6. Leadership and power. 7. The role of followers in leadership. 8. Past, present, and future of leadership. And finally, women in leadership. This book addresses theoretical and practical leadership concerns with case studies of great leaders. Available in digital and hard copy. Buy your copy today on marymugo.shopyangu.com or call us on 0776-045087. This book is also available on Amazon. Bless your order today and be on your way to greatness in leadership.